This is a story of two families, one of them happy, one of them sad, one of them clean, the other careless, one of them healthy, the other sick. Suppose we call them the clean family and the careless family. Now, how does it happen that the careless family is sick while the clean family is not? Well, let's see how the folks in the clean family live. They live in a clean little house that looks like this. Let's go inside. It's mealtime. Here's the mother cooking for the family. Notice that she cooks on a simple stove of brick. And for good reason. She wants the food to be kept clean. And see how clean her dishes are kept, and how clean the food is, protected from flies. And look outside here. This is how the clean family keeps the pigs and chickens, confined in a simple corral of stakes and thongs. This keeps the yard clean and also keeps the pigs and chickens from wandering into the house. And this means a clean house. Here's the father working in the cornfield with his son. This is indeed a happy family because it's a clean family. But let's compare this to the way the careless family lives. Here is their house. And here are some of their chickens. And here's their pig left loose in the yard. But let's go inside and meet the family. Hey, you, get out of there. You don't have any business in the house. Here is the mother cooking the family meal. She cooks on the floor, as has always been her custom. But this has disadvantages. Uh-oh, here's a chicken loose. And there's that nosy pig again. Cooking on the floor exposes the food to dirt and dust, and to the sicknesses that might be in dirt. The father is not able to work because he's sick. Little Johnny has stomach cramps, and he sits in the corner most of the time. Why should there be so much sickness in this home? Well, let's go back to the day when Johnny first became ill with the cramps. Poor Johnny, he was in great distress. And to make matters worse, there was no latrine, but there was a cornfield. That's where everyone went. It was the custom. But this was a very bad custom. Though Johnny didn't know it, he was soon to bring more sickness into his family. Why? Well, when a person has a sickness of the stomach, that which leaves his body also contains the sickness, and the sickness will live in the dirt where he's left it for many days. One morning, a few days later, the father went into the field to hoe his corn. Yes, the same field where Johnny had often come with his stomach cramps. The sickness was still living in the dirt where Johnny left it. Johnny's father found it hard work hoeing the long rows in the hot sun, and so he sat down for a few minutes to rest. Idly, he sifted the cool dirt through his fingers the way a true farmer will. That dirt had in it an evil sickness, the sickness left there in the field by Johnny. And even though he dusted the soil off his hands, the invisible sickness stayed. And so he carried it with him when he went home to dinner. And since he never washed his hands before eating, the sickness from the field was still on them. It got on the food he was eating. And the sickness went with the food into his stomach. Soon, he too became sick, worse even than Johnny. All this misery simply because they didn't know. How could Johnny know he should use a latrine? His family had no latrine. It was not their custom. What a careless family. But let's see what the clean family did about this same problem. The father put up a simple latrine. Here's how he built it. First, he dug a deep hole. Near at hand were some rough-hewn boards, some stakes cut from trees, and some thatched straw. Let's see how he used these simple materials. When the hole was deep enough, he laid the boards across it, leaving an opening in the center. Then he fashioned a covering for this opening to keep the flies out. Flies, too, can carry sickness if they walk in filth and then enter our homes. Then he placed the stakes at the four corners of the latrine. Now he was ready for the thatch, so he... Wait a minute. We seem to have a customer already. It's little Tommy. Excuse us, young man. Suppose we give you some privacy. There, that's more like it. That's what the thatch was for in the first place. Little Tommy has been taught to use this latrine instead of going into the field. The inside of the latrine is always kept neat and clean, and in this way, the sickness of the field is kept from spreading. The careless household is indeed a place of unhappiness. Because he never washes himself, Johnny is uncomfortable. He's always scratching. Tommy, on the other hand, gets a bath often. In fact, everyone in this careful family bathes often. To keep themselves clean, they wear clean clothes. Clothes washed with plenty of good soap. Clothes dried in the sunshine, in clean places, never in the dirt. The mother washes her hands to make them clean before she handles the food. She knows that sickness on food brings sickness to those who eat that food. The father and son also know about the sickness that may be in dirt, and so they wash their hands before eating. The clean family keep their dishes clean. They keep their food clean. They sweep their house to keep it clean. They keep their yard clean, and they bury all refuse that might attract flies or rats that bring sickness. They have a good latrine, and they keep it clean, and they keep their bodies clean. These are the reasons why they're strong and healthy. This is why they're happy. Always remember, cleanliness brings health and happiness.
Wait a minute. Don't let that sap tell you how to spend your money. Be smart. Spend it on yourself.
Okay, I will.
Wait. In times like these, everyone must do his share.
That's right.
Don't listen to him. Go ahead, spend it. Have a good time.
First, you must defend the country that makes a good time possible.
Curses, he's too smart. I'll have to blitz him. Hey, look, your petticoat's showing.
What makes a Nazi? How does he get that way? Well, let's look into the process. To begin with, Nazi control over a German child starts as soon as it's born. A young German couple has come to register the birth of their son.
Heil Hitler!
Heil Hitler!
Heil Hitler!
Herr Standesbeamte, wir möchten unseren Jungen anmelden. Unseren Erstgeborenen.
Gib alle Geburtsscheine.
Ja, hier sind unsere Geburtsscheine. Die Geburtsscheine unserer Eltern.
Those documents are birth certificates, all the way back to their great-grandparents, proving, of course, that they are pure Aryan.
Wir möchten auch gern wissen, ob wir uns.
The mother wants to call her son Hans.
Dieses Verzeichnis enthält alle männlichen Namen, die für Kinder
aus. Here's the verboten list. Mm-hmm. Hans seems to be okay for the time being.
Hier ist der Erbbierausweis, den Sie mal bei sich haben müssen.
This is their hereditary passport, with space for 12 future children. A subtle hint, Germany needs soldiers.
Für das deutsche Vaterland, ich bereiche Ihnen ein wertvolles Geschenk von unserem Führer.
As a reward, they get a copy of Germany's bestseller. Now let's see what happens to one of Hitler's children. Kindergarten, and little Hans learns the fairy tales of the new order. Remember the story of the Sleeping Beauty? Hans was taught that the Wicked Witch was democracy. And Sleeping Beauty? Who can she be?
Aha, here comes the prince. The prince is victorious. Democracy has fled.
The prince breaks the magic spell with a kiss. The beautiful princess is Germany. And the brave, handsome knight, you know who he is.
Heil Hitler!
Heil Hitler!
Heil!
Mach heile Sprache! Mach heile Schwierige, weil die Kinder auf was nicht mehr! Mach heile Stimme! Heil Hitler!
Hitler!
Nach Hengsa! Nach Reichen! Nach Hengsa! Nach Reichen! Nach Reichen! Nach Reichen! Nach Reichen! Nach Reichen! Nach Reichen!
This Nazi fairy tale seems to be that Hitler got Germany on her feet, climbed into the saddle, and took her for a ride. The distortion of this tale has its purpose in molding the young Nazi mind. Hitler becomes Hans's idol.
Sieg Heil! Sieg Heil! Sieg Heil!
But one day, Hans became sick. His mother is praying that her son get well. She knows that the unfit are taken away by the state and are never heard of again.
Muss kräftig sein. Sie holen die Schwachen fort und niemand weiß, was es ist.
Heil Hitler!
Heil Hitler!
Was ist denn schon wieder los mit Hans? Ist denn schon wieder krank? Was hat denn?
Mutter!
Ja.
Sie verwöhnen den Jungen! Aus dem wird nie ein guter Soldat! Sollte aus Hans ein untauglicher Schwächling werden. Sie wissen ja wohl, was ich meine. Nächstes Mal erwarte ich einen besseren Bericht. Dieser sentimentale Quatsch muss aufhören. Das bitte ich mir aus. Heil Hitler!
This Superman has just reminded Hans's mother that unless this mollycoddling stops, the state will have to step in and take over.
Ich schwöre, bedingungslosen Gehorsam für den Führer des Deutschen.
Hans recovered. Back in school, he's giving his daily pledge to fight, obey, and die for his Führer, which pleases the Führer very much. And Herr Goering. And Herr Goebbels, too.
Sehr gut. Sehr gut. Und nun, Kinder, werden wir unsere Naturkundestunde halten.
Hans's school teacher is about to give the class a little lesson in natural history.
Jetzt einen Hasen. Und nun zeichne ich einen Fuchs. Nun passt gut auf, was jetzt hier passiert.
Now let's see what they'll learn from this little lesson.
Wer kann mir sagen, was wir daraus lernen können? Hans?
Das arme Häschen.
He said the poor rabbit. Is he out of his mind?
Donnerwetter nochmal! Dummkopf! Was für eine blöde Antwort ist denn das? Geh in die Ecke! Was? Eins, zwei, drei! Eins, zwei, drei! Rauf auf den Stuhl!
What would the Führer think of such a stupid answer? What would Herr Goering say? And Herr Goebbels?
Dummkopf! Wer kann mir nur die richtige Antwort geben?
Now then, who can give the correct answer?
Ich weiß! Es zeigt uns, dass die Welt den Starken gehört!
The world belongs to the strong.
Und dem Brutalen!
And to the brutal.
Der Hase ist schwach und feige und verdient.
The rabbit is a coward and deserves to die. They spit on the rabbit. Nice kids.
Gut! Gut! Ausgezeichnet! Und nun, Hans, was denkst du jetzt von dem armen Häschen?
Ich hasse es. Es ist
he hates the rabbit. There's no room for weaklings. Hans is learning fast. My, how he hates that rabbit.
Ich hasse ihn.
So, das ist besser.
Hans has come around to the correct Nazi way of thinking. Nice going, eh, Adolf?
Ja, unsere Naturkunde lehrt uns, dass Deutschland...
Yes, this lesson is the basis for the Nazi creed. For Germany will likewise destroy all weak and cowardly nations.
Wir sind die nordische Rasse.
Alle anderen Völker werden unsere Sklaven sein.
Germans are a super race.
Sieg!
All others will be slaves.
Wir sind unübertrefflich. Wir fürchten niemand.
Germans are unconquerable. They fear no one. Listen to the fanatic cry.
Heute gehört uns Deutschland. Morgen die ganze Welt.
Today we own Germany. Tomorrow the whole world. Hans is now ready for the higher education, as decreed by the Führer. Marching and hiling, hiling and marching, Hans grows up. In him is planted no seed of laughter, hope, tolerance, or mercy. For him, only hiling and marching, marching and hiling, as the years grind on. Manhood finds him still hiling and marching. But the grim years of regimentation have done their work. Now he's a good Nazi. He sees no more than the party wants him to. Says nothing but what the party wants him to say. And he does nothing but what the party wants him to do. And so he marches on with his millions of comrades, trampling on the rights of others. For now his education is complete. His education for death.
Yes, a nice crowd. Good morning. Everything all right? That's good. Oh, dearie me, that's a nice one. Let's check that one. All righty, all righty. Oh, that's a beauty. Too small. Jim Dandy. Uh-oh, running a little low. Oh, dear, more fish, more fish. Keep them happy, keep them happy. And where do you think you're going?
Fish.
Give me that. Now go fish like a bear. Let's see now, brook trout, lake trout, golden trout, dolly vardens. Ah, here we are, rainbows. Dolly vardens and rainbows.
Thank you.
One side. Let's measure that. Too small. Kitties alone. Ow, ow, whoa, ow, whoa, ow, ow, ow. That's a good boy, Humphrey. Ah, here we are. Fish away. Yes, sir.
Well, stop it. Fishing season ended yesterday.
Yesterday? Oh, my goodness. Stop. Put it back. It's all over. Shoo, shoo. Get out of the park. Get. Sportsman. Bah. Fishing season's over. Fishing season is over.
We're gonna surprise Mickey with some cookies like his mother used to make.
La la. cookies?
They are no cookies. I just made them. Oh! I wanted to make the cookies like your mother used to make. And now they're all burned up. Oh!
My mother used to burn them all the time.
I just turn my heel to the hen house hill. Don't throw away that bacon grease. Housewives of America, one of the most important things you can do is to save your waste kitchen fats, bacon grease, meat drippings, frying fats. We and our allies need millions of pounds of fats to help win the war. For fats make glycerin, and glycerin makes explosives. Every year, 2 billion pounds of waste kitchen fats are thrown away. Enough glycerin for 10 billion rapid-fire cannon shells. A belt 150,000 miles long, six times around the Earth. A skillet of bacon grease is a little munitions factory. Meat drippings sink Axis warships. Waste frying fats speed depth charges on their way to crush Axis submarines. Your pound of waste fat will give some boy at the front an extra clip of cartridges.
Do you still want the bacon grease, Pluto?
Pour your waste kitchen fats in a clean, wide-mouthed can. That's right, not a glass jar or paper bag. Please strain the fats through a kitchen sieve. Keep in a cool, dark place so it won't become rancid. When you have a pound or more, take it to your neighborhood meat dealer, who is patriotically cooperating. He will weigh the fat and pay you for it.
So you want weenies instead of money. Okay, catch them.
Save waste fats to make explosives. Look for the official insignia in your meat dealer's window.
This is a story of Susie. She was a beautiful new car, and she sat in a big auto showroom all day long flirting with the people passing by. One day, her flashing grill caught the eye of a neat little man in a brown suit. When he saw Susie, it was love at first sight.
Isn't she a beauty? Why, she's the sweetest little car money can buy. I know you'll be happy with her. And now, if you'll just sign here, my friend, she's all yours.
Yeah, it was as simple as that, and Susie was sold. Susie was a happy little car. She glided down the avenue. The minute she stepped out on the main drag, Susie found herself in pretty fast company. But then she had a lot of pep and pickup, and she soon learned her way around. Susie loved the parking lot society, where she could rub fenders with the best of them. She met all the big wheels, big cabs, dignified limousines. It was a great place to make new contacts. Oop, sorry. But at the end of the day, it felt mighty good to be home in her own cozy little garage, where she could just relax and let her tires cool off. But as the years passed, Susie's mileage rolled up and she began to show her age. Her color was fading, and she developed carburetor trouble. And she was losing some of her old pep and pickup, too.
Hey! Get this stalling!
Get moving!
Susie was all run down and long overdue for a checkup.
Well, afraid she's in pretty bad shape, mister. Fact is, she needs a complete overhaul.
No, no. What I need is a new car.
See Maniac Martin. We're not selling them, folks. We're giving them away. We know we're crazy, but look at the...
What was to become of Susie? Who would want a worn-out old coupe? Was back streets and dark alleys. Susie was on Skid Row. Susie was left out in the cold. Abused, neglected, she soon lost all her self-respect. It was plain to see that she was getting out of line. one dark night, as she sat all by herself on a lonely street, a stranger stepped out of the shadows. Her oil ran cold. Susie was a stolen car.
Calling car 47. Watch for stolen car. Small blue coupe. License number A72.
The end had come. She was a battered old wreck, and they dragged her away to the junkyard. Susie had come to the end of her road.
Hey, mister! What do you want for this old blue heap here?
Say about $15.
Oh, gee whiz, I've only got $12.50.
Well, take her away, son. She's all yours.
They stripped her fenders, chopped her top, shackled her down, and hopped her up. She felt 50,000 miles younger. It was a miracle. That's what it was. And it couldn't have happened to a nicer little car.
Hello there. What's the matter? Why are you so sad?
I'd like to be in the parade, but I haven't any pretty clothes to wear.
Now don't be so downhearted. There's no need to cry. You're going to be the Cookie Queen, all alone the reason why.
Oh.
Go out to pick your hair up. Here's the way to do it. There's nothing to it. You're you're going to be the sweetest one of all. But you're pretty. Yumpty dumpty diddy. Just wait and see. You're going to be the sweetest one of all.
Said no to everyone. What can we do?
What can we do?
What can we do?
What can we do?
My advice would be, marry me.
No me.
No me.
Perhaps you better marry all three.
The king,
the king,
the king,
the king, the king!
Hail, oh hail, the king,
the king!
Let your voice as ring,
voice as ring!
when it comes to cutting up. I can grab the chicken's gizzard on the wishbone of a pup. And here's the great experiment I'm just about to tackle, to find out if the net result will bark or crow or cackle.
Of dollars pouring into the hands of the American worker. Now, in the mind of the average worker live two separate personalities. One, the thrifty.
Wait a bit, laddie. You're going to save a bit of that, aren't you?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Oftentimes, idle money burns a hole in your pocket, which brings out the other personality, the spendthrift.
Hi, big shot. Come on with me. I'll show you how to spend your dough.
Oh, boy, oh, boy, oh, boy!
I got a couple of good beats.
But, laddie, I've got some better deets.
Important ones, too. When every American should pay his or her income tax gladly and proudly. This year, thanks to Hitler and Hirohito, taxes are higher than ever before. Will you have enough money on hand to meet your payments when they fall due?
We'll take care of that later. Forget it, forget it.
But you don't want to forget our fighting men, do you?
Yes, sir.
Then you'll have to start saving right away to meet your tax payments.
Listen, chum. Spend it. It's your dough.
Yeah, it's my dough.
Aye, laddie. It's your dough. But it's your war, too. You must save for victory.
What's money for? Spend it. Shoot the works.
Nay, you must save it. Spend. Save.
Spend.
Well, now what are you going to do? Spend for the Axis? Or save for taxes? Just remember, every dollar you spend for something you don't need is a dollar spent to help the Axis. That's right. And every dollar you sock away for taxes is another dollar to sock the Axis. For it is your taxes, my taxes, our taxes that run the factories. American factories, working day and night. Factories making guns, machine guns, anti-tank guns, long-range guns, guns, all kinds of guns. To blast the aggressors from the seas. Taxes for American factories, working full blast, making planes. Bombers, dive bombers. Flying fortresses, interceptors, stalk the birds of prey that fly by night. To bury the Axis. Taxes. Taxes for ships, battleships, battle cruisers, destroyers, all kinds of battle wagons. Sink the Axis. Taxes to keep them flying. Taxes to keep them rolling. Taxes to keep them coming. Taxes to beat to earth the evil destroyer of freedom and peace. This is our fight. The fight for freedom. Freedom of speech. Of worship. Freedom from want and fear. Taxes will keep democracy on the march.
Sing and dance while there's danger all about. You should get your houses wolf-proofed. Bricks like these will keep him out.
Who's afraid of the big bad wolf? Big bad wolf, big bad wolf. Who's afraid of the big bad wolf?
I'll huff and I'll puff and I'll blow your house in.
Stop his blowing, they will also get him going.
Who's afraid of the big bad wolf?
The Union Jack's still waving.
We'll be safe from the big bad wolf if you lend your saving.
Public enemy number one, Anopheles, the malaria mosquito. Wanted for willful spreading of disease and theft of working hours. For bringing sickness and misery to untold millions in many parts of the world. This tiny criminal is linked to the destinies of man in a cycle of disease transmission that could not exist without either man or mosquito. Each is solely dependent on the other for the existence of the dread malaria. Anopheles is readily distinguished from other mosquitoes by the fact that she stands on her head at an angle of 45 degrees or more. This newly hatched female has not yet touched human blood, therefore does not contain malaria. But if we follow her, we'll soon learn how she becomes a malaria carrier. Like all thieves and killers, she works best under cover of darkness. Locking and barring doors and windows will not keep this hungry prowler out. She can enter through a small crack.
What will she find to steal here? Only a little blood, which this man, racked with the chills and fever of malaria, will never miss. Assuming her typical angle of 45 degrees or more, she injects saliva to make penetration easier. And in a few seconds, she begins to feed. But this man is sick. Along with his blood, she's drinking in the parasites, which cause malaria. Gorged with disease-laden blood, she makes her way to some cool, dark place, where she will rest for several days and digest the blood. Although the blood is digested, the disease parasites are not harmed in any way. On the contrary, they multiply to great numbers. Hungry again, she flies out as evening falls in search of blood. This time she carries with her the malaria parasites with which she is infected. Enjoying the peace and plenty of the home he's worked so hard to build, this man is healthy and happy. Little does he suspect he's to be the victim of this bloodthirsty vampire. Again, saliva is injected to make penetration easy. But this time, the saliva contains malaria parasites, which enter the bloodstream. She dines on healthy blood, and in payment leaves the chills and fever of malaria. In all probability, this man will not die. But neither will he truly be alive, for he'll be continually in poor health, unable to work and keep up his farm. Slowly he will lose all he has worked for. His crops will rot in the fields. His buildings and fences fall into disrepair. His livestock will be neglected, and he'll be unable to earn the money to feed and clothe his family. Multiply this man's tragedy by numberless cases all over the world, and we have millions of dollars lost, as well as untold misery for the victims. And all because of this tiny criminal, which has assumed the proportions of a monster. Are there six or seven people in the audience who will volunteer to help us combat this evil? Good. Well, thank you, men. But before we can attack the enemy, there are certain facts we must know. The first and all-important fact is this. The Anopheles mosquito must have water to lay her eggs in. These eggs float about and soon hatch into larvae or wigglers, which lie parallel to the surface where they feed and breathe. In this larva stage, the mosquito is easy to control. After 7 to 10 days, the larva becomes a pupa or tumbler and can still be controlled. But once she emerges from the pupa as an adult, she can slip through our fingers and become a menace to human life within a mile of her birthplace. All right, men, now we can begin to fight. We can start by cutting the weeds where the mosquito lays her eggs. This makes it easy for the fish to get in and eat the wigglers. Spraying oil on the water is a sure way of killing mosquito larvae of all kinds. The oil enters the breathing tube and promptly kills the wiggler. Those are wigglers, Dopey. Give them the oil treatment. That'll kill them. Dusting with Paris Green is an effective way of killing wigglers and is economical for covering large areas of water. A thin film of Paris Green is strong enough to kill the wigglers without poisoning the fish. Mosquitoes must have water to breed in. These pools will always be a menace to our health unless we drain the water away. There's one way of doing it. Even this hollow stump can harbor mosquito larvae. Say, that looks like smoke. Let's go in and see.
Attaboy, dopeys. Spray all the dark corners and under things. You'll find mosquitoes where you least expect them. Yes, we've got to kill everyone in the house. The permanent way to get rid of breeding places is to fill them with dirt. If you want to keep the rain barrel free from wigglers, let's put a screen over it. By covering the cracks in the walls with building paper, we can keep mosquitoes out. Anything that holds water for a few days is a likely breeding place for mosquitoes. And we can't afford to take any chances. So we're going to bury these cans. To be safe from malaria, we must put screens over all the doors and windows. Screens can save you a lot of misery.
Attaboy, dopey. Killer, good and dead.
To avoid being bitten by anopheles, we must put netting over the beds. Then we can sleep in safety. Don't let her get away. She's a killer. Yes, even the small cracks in the floor must be sealed.
And so we leave them to enjoy their well-earned rest. Free from the annoyance of mosquitoes, safe from the dread malaria. Contrast their peace and happiness with the misery and sorrow of this unfortunate plague-ridden family. These people have lost everything simply because they failed to take a few easy precautions. Remember, there is only one cause of malaria, the mosquito. Destroy the mosquito and you will wipe out the disease. Then, in place of sickness and poverty, there will be health, safety, and happiness.